case number 110982, State of Kansas v. Marlon T. Hardy.
May it please the court, Richard Ney appearing for the appellee below, Marlon Hardy, and the petitioner for review in this case. Mr. Chief Justice, I'd ask to reserve 3 minutes of my time for rebuttal.
3 minutes is granted.
Thank you. In brief summary, Mr. Hardy was charged by the state with aggravated battery in the shooting of an individual, Mr. Flores. He raised prior to trial the claim of immunity based on self-defense under KSA 2152-31. The court heard that, the court below heard that issue and ruled in Mr. Hardy's favor, the state appeal. Your Honor, the Court of Appeals here reversed the court below, remanding it for further proceedings. We believe that the panel of the Court of Appeals misinterpreted and misapplied this court's decision in Altreras in a number of ways. First, the panel applied a de novo standard of review here instead of what we submit would be the correct standard deferential standard under what Altreras would lead us to believe. This court in Altreras relied upon the Rogers case from Kentucky, which had a similar law. And that case from 2009 dealt with one of these issues. What is the standard? When this is presented to a court, is it de novo? Is there deference given to the court's fact finding? The court in Rogers, which again this court relied on in reaching its decision, Altreras, said that claims of immunity in a similar statute should be viewed in the same way as reviewing a probable cause determination by a magistrate when dealing with search warrant or other matters. And that, of course, as this court knows under its decision in Hicks and other cases, we know that that's a deferential standard, that we give the court below fact-finding, clear deference. And that's what should have happened in this case to Judge Kaufman's fact-finding. But instead, the Court of Appeals looked at it very differently than that. Instead of accepting all the evidence and the inferences to be drawn in the light that the way the court below saw it, the Court of Appeals said that appellate courts apparently should impose their own decision on that.
Wasn't it, I understand your argument. My understanding of the Court of Appeals ruling, however, is more of along the lines of the Court of Appeals said, this is like a preliminary hearing, and the district court actually doesn't have a true fact-finding role.
Well, But the Rogers case would say it's more like a warrant determination.
And the reason that the reviewing court would give deference to a lower court in the warrant situation is because that magistrate is considering the totality of the circumstances. It is doing some kind of a fact-finding type weighing of the full circumstances. I mean, it seems to me that the hurdle that you have in is the Court of Appeals analogizing this to a preliminary hearing in which the district court is required to consider all the facts in light most favorable to the state.
And there's nothing, of course, in Altreras or Rogers or the Florida Supreme Court in David, as we've cited, that says that. It says just the opposite, in fact. The court should have the ability to determine, to do fact-finding here. Otherwise, what's the point of the statute? In fact, this court in Altreras said this wasn't just a probable cause determination. I think the language was, court talks about the statute, this court talks about the statute, says the statute is written with a probable cause standard, adds an additional requirement, and is meaningful. Well, what is that requirement? The requirement that the state prove this wasn't self-defense. If we're saying that any thing that the state says has to be accepted without any weighing by the court, then the statute really is meaningless. This statute was enacted, whether you say by Second Amendment folks or whatever, but by people who believed self-defense was important, and that someone not only should be able to raise that defense, but not even be prosecuted if there are findings that a court makes that it was an acting in self-defense.
Mr. Ney?
Yes?
Should we focus at all at this stage of these proceedings on whether there must be an evidentiary hearing as opposed to permitting consideration of evidence that would not be admissible in a formal hearing?
Well, in
the
this case...
The Court of Appeals said you had to have one.
Right. I mean, in this case, the state raises, gee, there really wasn't a hearing. But of course there was. Judge Coffman heard the preliminary hearing. He considered all of the evidence from that hearing, all the testimony. There were several witnesses. But then he told the state, when the motion was filed, look, we'll conduct a hearing. And you can bring in anything you want. In fact, the court said you can bring in affidavits, documents, call witnesses, more witnesses. I don't care. Whatever you want to put on, state, I'm going to listen to. Now, whether that's appropriate or not, I don't know. Certainly, we're not complaining about it. I guess if it really had been the other way, that might be. But the state had carte blanche to bring in anything. And then a hearing was conducted. The state introduced 9 exhibits, as well as the preliminary hearing testimony.
And isn't it also true that the state declined the district court's offer to actually hold an evidentiary hearing?
Yes. I mean, they called no witnesses.
Right.
They presented evidence through affidavits and reports, which we did not object to.
So I guess my question is, if we accept your argument that this statute requires the district court to find facts, typically on a going forward basis, that would require some kind of taking of evidence pursuant to the rules of evidence. But what do we do with this case where the state was offered that and said, we don't want it?
Well, I heard waiver a lot earlier this morning. Maybe the state has waived its right to complain about that if they did not. In fact, the prosecutor said, that's fine. Plenty of time. We'll present whatever we want, and did so. So I think waiver applies potentially to the state there as well.
We have a statute that covers a lot of points. I mean, beginning with arrest and then detention, prosecution, et cetera. Do we look at that broad spectrum as we try to determine how this is handled? And by that I mean, obviously, at the point of arrest or the point of detention, there's not going to be an evidentiary hearing. So is the process the same throughout the whole process? Or once you hit a court, the rules change and there's a different process? How do we look at that?
Well, I mean, that's an interesting question. Obviously, you have individuals who do not have counsel when they're arrested. So how are they going to raise this appropriately? But I think once the right of counsel attaches, certainly, I think when the attorney for the defendant raises the issue, that calls into question. In this case, we did it after the preliminary hearing, because frankly, the preliminary hearing was key for us to understand that this was absolutely self-defense. And I think that's what's critical. And frankly, you know, the big issue here that the state raised, the difference was the matter of a couple of seconds. When I cross-examined Mr. Flores, I asked him questions. This is at the preliminary hearing, and he was very clear. I said what he had testified before. I said, I wrote it down. Right before I stopped punching, I heard the shot. Yes. And that's true, isn't it? Yes. Right before you stopped punching, that's when I heard the shot. In other words, Flores has testified. He's reaching in the car. It's a convertible. Pounding my client in the head. And here's the shot right before he stops punching. His friend is trying to pull him off. He pushes his friend away. The car can't even move because it's surrounded by this group of individuals. On my co-defendant's attorney's questioning, he changes that slightly, and usually the co-defendant hurts you worse than the prosecutor sometimes. But he said, he changed the testimony that he heard the shot immediately after he punched the defendant. Here, after he punched Mr. Hardy. So the question is, he's punching as he hears the shot. He punched him, he heard that immediately after he punched him, he heard the shot. In fact, that's the big issue here, that I think that the state raises. That's the big issue of inconsistency or what the court was having to be a fact finder on is when the shot happened. Interestingly enough, the court in its ruling gave deference to the state on that issue. The court rule, it talks about what happened. The victim was very close to the defendant, and the time between the punches and the shot fired is mere seconds. I point out that Yulee, who was another witness, specifically said 1 second was the time frame between the punches and the shot, the sole shot that the defendant fired, but a fair inference can be drawn as a factual finding that more accurately, 3 seconds at best is a better conclusion based on Yulee's description of events. So again, the issue was, Flores testified he was punching when he was shot. He only a second hit, he immediately after the punch he was shot, but the court gave the fact finding to the state.
At counsel, as I read the briefs and the whole record in this case, what it appears to me to boil down to is who gets to decide that fact dispute. Is it the district court at a preliminary stage, or is it the jury? That's how I see this case. And then I think that my question is, we're interpreting the statute. Where does the where does the statute place that fact-finding role? What do we look to the actual language of the statute to help us answer that question? Is this a jury question, or is it a preliminary question that ought to be handled by the district court?
If it's a jury question, we don't even get to the statute, because under the statute, you don't even get to prosecute my client.
So as far as a question of statutory interpretation, your yes. case hinges on the word immunity, doesn't it?
It does.
Okay.
But my point is, we're reaching here, arguing, and the Court of Appeals somehow says that the court did not resolve the issues in favor of the state. That's the only issue I find in dispute, this timing. And the court did give the state the benefit of doubt. It gave them 3 seconds, where a witness at a second, and the complainant himself, Mr. Flores, says it was basically immediately, you know, one side or the other of the shot, of the punch, the shot was. So I don't understand that position.
The ultimate fact question isn't how many seconds. The ultimate fact question is, did your client act in self-defense, right?
Right. And that's what the court decided. And the court applied the fact that he was being hit while he was seated.
Do you disagree with the Court of Appeals' conclusion that had this truly been, let's say the statute didn't exist. The state did present enough evidence, presuming a preliminary hearing, to get to the jury, to take this fact question to the jury, but for the statute, right?
Yes.
Okay.
But, I mean, I think the
So it really is irrelevant, how many seconds elapsed. And so I understand your argument, and it's compelling, I think. I guess my point is just, it really comes down to, does this go to the jury or not?
Well, it only goes to the jury when the court makes the gatekeeper decision
that the state has met its burden to demonstrate probable cause that the defendant did not act in self-defense.
And as Judge Coffman clearly said, to your question, Justice Steele, there's a difference between a preliminary hearing finding, which he made, and the hearing and the finding he made under this statute. They're apples and oranges, and I agree with Judge Coffman on his analysis of that. Unless there are other questions, my time has expired.
Thank you, counsel.
May it please the court and counsel, Assistant District Attorney Matt Maloney for the state. I guess to start, obviously we are here on petition for review, and our position as the state is that the Court of Appeals panel got this right, both in the result and in its analysis. And I certainly am not here today to presume that I have any additional or better wisdom than the panel did. Well, as
counsel, as Mr. Nay, argued, why isn't the Court of Appeals panel's ruling just a complete sort of vitiation of the statute, reading the statute out of the books?
Well, I think, and I want to tie that into the first argument that counsel raised with respect to the standard of review and his position that this should be something that the appellate court has to give deference to the trial court, and that it was incorrect to rule that de novo review applied. The issue that the district, that we asked the Court of Appeals to review when we filed our state's appeal in this case, really boils down to interpreting the statute. That is always something that is reviewed with de novo review, unlimited review regarding the interpretation of a statute. That was the task that the Court of Appeals was called to rule upon based on our appeal in this case. They had to look at the statute and based on the statutory language and looking at case law to some extent, they had to determine how this statute is meant to apply.
So that gets back to my question. How is it that the Court of Appeals' interpretation of this statute doesn't render it a nullity?
I think, as the panel explained and as we argued in the brief, it does not make the self-defense statute or the immunity statute meaningless any more so than a normal preliminary hearing is meaningless, simply because at a preliminary hearing, the district court is called upon to resolve evidentiary disputes.
Given the state's position and the Court of Appeals ruling, how would this defendant be any different had this statute never been passed? How would his case have proceeded in any different way?
Because the statute does require additional proof on the state's part that doesn't normally apply to preliminary.
Isn't that always the case when a defendant raises self-defense?
If they raise immunity at a preliminary, no. Yes.
With me that there is no immunity. That we're just in the land that existed prior to this statute. The defendant still, self-defense was still available as a defense, correct?
At trial, yes.
Well, why wouldn't it have been available at the preliminary hearing stage?
Well, he certainly could. I understand your question. Yes, it would have been available at the preliminary hearing to the extent that he was trying to avoid having to go to trial.
There are at least three different stages then where the defendant could assert self-defense. The preliminary hearing, and then after the court looks at his motion asserting self-defense immunity, and if that doesn't win, then at trial, saying this is all self-defense. Is that right?
Yes, and I think that perhaps even a fourth time, which the panel hinted at, would be even before the case was charged, you could preemptively file, if you are aware of the fact that you're being investigated for a crime, you could preemptively try and file some sort of motion, which I think the panel noted is probably not real likely to happen, but it's certainly possible. There's nothing precluding it.
Because arrest is contained in the definition of criminal prosecution for which the defendant is supposed to be immune.
Right. Our position is that the statute is not rendered meaningless, again, because it does require, and keeping in the context of the preliminary hearing, it requires the state to prove an additional factor that the state does not otherwise have to prove in a case where a defendant has not asserted immunity.
And what is that factor? How would you state that fact?
Well, it's our burden of proving that the defendant's use of self-defense or defense of others, whatever the case may be, was not justified.
And that's the state's burden of proof.
It's our burden of proof by
a proponent. If we have a judge that said the state failed to meet its burden of proof to prove probable cause to believe that the use of force was unjustified, why isn't that a negative finding? Why are we deciding this de novo?
Because it's our position that in this case, that decision was based on the district court's incorrect interpretation of the statute. I think the district court very clearly indicated that he simply had no idea because there had not been yet any case law guidance on the procedures on how this actually played out. He knew that it was the state's burden by a probable cause standard, but as far as determining the procedures for how this gets implemented, that's where he indicated, I don't know because there is nothing to guide me on that. And so he just essentially said, I'm going to give my best guess, make my best guess here as to how this should apply.
But you're not saying that the trial judge ignored any evidence, disregarded any evidence?
I don't know that he disregarded any evidence. Our position is that he did incorrectly weigh the evidence.
So if we're in a de novo review based on an interpretation of a statute, where in the statute do we find the state's position that the district court should view all the evidence in the light most favorable to the state?
Certainly there's nothing explicitly in the statute, and that's where it comes into statutory interpretation rather than just reading the plain language.
How do we get there? What's your best argument that this statute incorporates that standard?
I think the best argument is simply that the only standard that we see at all in the statute is probable cause. And I think that's where the Court of Appeals said the only standard we have is probable cause.
What in the law would lead us to be convinced that probable cause, that phrase probable cause, imports with it a burden or a rule that says the district court should view all the evidence in the light most favorable to the state?
I think just the comparison to the preliminary examination, that's the one.
As I read the Court of Appeals opinion, that was the only thing that they, I just wondered if you thought there was anything else that we could look to other than that.
No, I think that is the best answer. And I think that when you are, again, when the statute itself does not come out and explicitly say, that's where, in whatever context you're talking about, the appellate court does have to try and interpret the language.
But in other contexts where probable cause is found, we use the totality of the circumstances.
And I think the panel acknowledged that in even in a preliminary hearing, the court is still supposed to consider all of the evidence, and they are called upon to do some basic credibility determinations, but it's only in those extreme circumstances where the court can determine that the evidence in the state's favor is just so wholly incredible that it would not sustain the state's burden of proof. So to that extent, there is some limited role for the court to make just those base level credibility findings. But in the run-of-the-mill case where it's not something where the testimony is so incredible that there's simply no rational fact finder that could believe it, then in other circumstances, yes, the court should weigh that in the light most favorable. And
why? I'm not sure I understood an answer, or maybe I just, why does the totality of the circumstances test not apply?
Well, again, I think it does.
Especially going back to the question I ask, where we're looking at possibly this issue arising very early, at arrest or at detention or early on in the stages, why would we not treat it in the same way we would look at a probable cause determination for a warrant?
Well, again, I think that there is some totality, there is a totality of the circumstances analysis the court should look at the hearing that the Court of Appeals contemplates at the preliminary hearing. The court should consider the totality of the evidence, both presented by the state and by the defendant, if any.
And isn't that different than saying looking at in the light most favorable to the state?
I don't think so. And again, I think the panel discussed that to the extent that even in a preliminary hearing where it is well settled that they are to resolve to view the evidence in the light most favorable to the state, there is still that initial role of looking at the totality of the circumstances and the evidence and then making that initial baseline determination of whether the evidence is completely incredible. And if they determine that it is, then at that point, even reviewing the evidence in the light most favorable to the state would not be able to meet its burden of probable cause in that situation. And so I think in this situation, it's the same. It's just focused on a different factor instead of simply determining whether the state has proven elements 1, 2, and 3 of the crime. You also have to determine whether they have met its burden, the state's met its burden of overcoming the immunity statute. And I focus to this point, obviously, in the abstract on the statute and how it should be interpreted. I want to emphasize, as I did in the brief, that our position when you turn to the facts of this particular case is that even if you want to give deference to the trial court, that the findings were not supported by the facts in this case. What we have here is a situation where the defendant was a passenger in a vehicle. The victim came to the car. There were some other people surrounding the car. At first, the victim verbally taunted or taunted, I guess would be the best word, the defendant and the driver. The victim ultimately punched the defendant 2 or 3 times in the face. There is absolutely no testimony that the victim ever tried to enter the vehicle. Now, I guess we could have a theoretical debate on whether throwing a punch that might break the plane of the of an open window is entering, but there's certainly no testimony that he was actually trying to get into a vehicle in the way that most people would interpret that. There's also, the evidence shows, the victim was not armed. There was no testimony that he ever threatened, said that he was going to kill or injure or do anything to the defendant. We never had any testimony from the driver of the vehicle that he felt that he was in any way in danger of death or great bodily harm. The defendant never provided any testimony to his subjective belief. The only statement that he gave to police was to deny that he was at the scene. Basically, to find that the statute applies in this case would be to say that anytime somebody gets punched, they can pull out a gun and shoot somebody.
Tell me where I'm wrong with my understanding of the facts. There were 10 individuals that surrounded the car and made it impossible for that car to leave without running over someone. Is that true?
I don't know the exact number.
And
yes.
While the victim was punching the defendant, he tried to cover up and said stop at least once and maybe more than once.
I don't recall that specifically. I have no reason to doubt that your memory is right. But again, getting punched in the face 2 or 3, there's again no indication that he did fear for his life or for his friend's life. He chose not.
Isn't that an objective standard?
Well, it's a two-prong. It's subjective and objective. And I would argue that simply evidence that somebody got punched in the face, and don't get me wrong, I don't want to be punched in the face 2 or 3 times. I'm not saying that it's a pleasant experience, but I don't think that absent some objective evidence that this victim was Mike Tyson or that he was saying, I'm going to kill you or I've got a weapon. This is obviously outside the record.
He had made racial slurs.
He had made a racial slur.
Was he charged with aggravated battery or any crime?
I don't want to misstate the record. I don't remember off the top of my head. But again, this situation, and again, I'm not minimizing the fact that the victim or that the defendant was in a position that clearly would be uncomfortable. And yes, it would be very unpleasant to feel like you're not able to leave and drive away. But that still doesn't mean that you have displayed either an objective or subjective belief that you are in imminent danger of death or great bodily harm. If what happened in this case is sufficient, then as I argued in the brief, any bar fight, basically anytime anybody gets punched in any circumstance where they're not able to immediately flee, would mean that whoever gets hit first is then justified in pulling out a gun and shooting. That simply does not seem to be a reasonable interpretation of the evidence. And I also want to point out that this case, the guidance that we do have from Ultreras and Jones in particular, tells us that the immunity needs to be asserted as soon as possible before trial, and they say the reason to do that is because that then triggers the state's probable cause burden. I would argue that likewise, if a defendant is going to assert immunity, they not only need to do it in a timely manner, but it needs to be done specifically. In this case, the motion that the defense filed was very generic. It simply asserted, it didn't specify, to my recollection, whether he was asserting that he was defending himself, whether he was defending his friend, or whether he was asserting that he was defending from an entry into a vehicle. And I think that that lack of specificity here shows in the court's ruling. The court based its finding on defending from an entry into a vehicle, whereas the only subsection that the defendant cited in the statute had to do with defending himself or another person. And so if the state needs to be, if the state's burden is triggered by a timely assertion, it should also require a specific assertion so that the state knows what it must overcome. Again, we acknowledge it is our burden to overcome this. But how are we to overcome something if we don't even know what the target that the defendant is asserting for us to overcome? So again, our position is that the Court of Appeals got this right, and as far as the overarching question of how does the statute apply, what standard do we use, does the district court need to review the evidence in the light most favorable to the state? Even if you disagree with me on that, our position is that even if you look at the evidence in a more deferential manner, there simply is no evidence of the defendant's subjective belief. And I recognize that I would have an uphill climb in trying to say that the defendant should have to get on the stand and testify, because I realize there would be some concerns there. But nevertheless, the subjective belief can be presented other ways than through actual testimony on the stand. He could have given a statement in which he said, yeah, I pulled out the gun and shot because I thought this guy was about to kill me, or because he was about to kill my friend. Or he could put on a subjective belief maybe if the driver had testified and said, yeah, we were both sitting there scared for our life, and we thought that even though all that had happened so far was that the guy punched us a couple of times, we thought that he was on the verge of coming in the vehicle. We thought we saw a weapon. There was simply none of that. And I would argue that not only does that fail the subjective prong, but it cannot be said that a reasonable person would think that getting punched in the face twice or three times is the same as an imminent risk of death or great bodily harm. Otherwise, as I've reiterated a couple of times today, anybody who gets punched in just about any circumstance would then be able to successfully claim immunity. I know I'm well past my time. I think I've articulated our position. If there are no further questions, we would respectfully ask that the Court of Appeals be affirmed and that the District Court be reversed.
Any more questions? Thank you, Counsel.
Thank you.
May it please the court. Apparently, the state is saying now that the burden has somehow shifted to the defendant. Let's remember, this statute puts the burden clearly on the state to make this proving. As far as no reasonable person, Judge Kaufman made a specific finding that the defendant here, Mr. Hardy, was in risk of serious bodily injury. He was in a car, bigger individuals punching down at him repeatedly and would not stop. They say, the state argues here, it doesn't apply, that these facts are just not the right facts for this statute. Here's a little bit of my cross-examination of Mr. Flores. Then you go to the passenger and you confront him. Yes, and Lewis, this is his friend Lewis, Mr. Flores' friend, and Mr. Flores says, grabs me, tells me, they're not tripping. So his friend is trying to tell him, hey, they're okay. I say, okay, but you are not persuaded by that. You won't be stopped, will you? Uh-uh. Is that right? Yes. You push Lewis away from you. Yes. You physically assault your own friend, don't you? I pushed him away, out of the way, and then that's when I went to the passenger and started swinging at him. Started punching him in the head, I asked. Yeah. And he is seated in a car. Yeah. He can't really defend himself from you, can he? Yes, that's correct, isn't it? Yes. And you're much bigger than the passenger was, weren't you? Yes. If this isn't it, Your Honors, it doesn't exist. If that is not enough, the testimony of the alleged victim in this case, it's not enough. And Justice Johnson, Mr. Flores was charged with nothing in this case. Judge Kaufman was correct. He applied the correct standard. The state said this is not even entry in a car. You can't use the no duty to retreat and the right to self-defense. Fact, it's a convertible. If I have a client who reaches into a convertible and takes a tape off the front seat, he's going to be charged with burglary. We all know that. It's not a burglary because there's no roof to the car. This was an entry in the car, as Judge Kaufman rightly found. Car my client was sitting in legally. He covered himself up, trying to ward off the blows, and couldn't. He yelled, "Stop." Yuli, the young lady who was a witness, a friend of Mr. Bradley's, the driver, testified they were afraid, that Bradley and Hardy were afraid, in her opinion. I don't know what more is necessary. Either this statute exists and we're going to apply it or we're not, but if these aren't the facts, Your Honors, the facts don't exist. Thank you.
I just have one follow-up question. You've advocated that we look to a kind of warrant type analysis, totality of the circumstances. In a different case, which I'm sure you're familiar with, Judge Arnold Berger wrote a dissent on this issue, suggesting that we might analogize to a motion to suppress and that kind of a standard. Do you have a preference between those two? Do you have any thoughts to?
I go to the issue of the warrant because the Rogers Court in Kentucky and the cases that followed Rogers, the Kentucky line of cases and the Florida line of cases, David, talk about this kind of fact-finding. For example, the deference given to a magistrate when a warrant is issued. That's why I went there. I'm not sure which would be preferable.
The distinction seems to me to be that generally, well, I think all the time, in a warrant context, the magistrate is only getting one side of the story, whereas in a motion to suppress type context, there is a true, or at least there can be, a true conflict of evidence.
Right, which this court gives deference to the fact-finding. I'm not sure it would make any true difference.
I guess that's my question. Does it make any difference?
Not that I can see at first blush.
Any more questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you both for your arguments this morning. Court will take this matter under advisement. That concludes.